Welcome back. In this module, we're going to talk about taxes, a very important part of financial planning. In this module, we're going to go over different types of taxes, as well as understanding why do we have to pay tax. And then specifically, you will have an opportunity to compute federal income tax and learn step by step how to do that. You understand the difference between income, taxable income, and also taxes. In addition to learning how to do taxes, we'll also go over resources that are available to you and also how to incorporate tax strategies into your personal financial plan. So let's get started. There's a general perception that tax is very complicated. Well, is it true? Let's find out. In one sense, tax can be complicated because tax laws change every year. In this module, we're going to focus on the big topics that are common to all individuals. So we'll not go into the minutiae of taxes, but rather the overarching big picture of taxes. So the good news is that taxes for individuals are not complicated at all. One thing that a lot of people have a misconception on is the difference between withholding versus taxes. Withholding is not the same as tax. Withholding is the amount that is taken out of your paycheck in preparation for paying future taxes. At April 15 every year, individual in the United States will have to figure out how much they actually owe in terms of taxes. And if they owe more than what is withheld, they have to pay additional amount. If their actual taxable amount is smaller than their withholding, then they'll actually get a refund. An important part of this module is also to let you know what are some of the special circumstances where an expert in tax is needed. So when that happens, you will need to consult a tax accountant and a tax lawyer. But we'll give you the basic understanding and you'll get to know what you do not know. First, let's go over different types of taxes. The one that most of us are familiar with are income tax. And income tax can be at the federal level and state level. And for some individuals, they may even have to pay local tax. An example is New York City. Income tax are the most common, and this includes wages, as well as interest on your savings account or interest on bonds, dividends on stocks or dividends on mutual funds. It also includes prize money. So this can be gambling prices. It can be tournament prices. So all this, you may have to pay income tax. And this, we'll go over that. Most of our discussion focus on the federal income tax. Individual states vary greatly. Some states have income tax on all of the above. Some states do not tax wages. Famous ones will include New Hampshire and Florida. But in New Hampshire, you do have to pay tax on interest and dividends. So it's not that it has no tax on everything. As we mentioned, we'll focus on federal because we will not have time to go over all 50 states and their different tax implications. But the idea is the same. And again, the majority of your tax is federal tax. So that's where our focus will be. The second type of tax are called Medicare tax, and this is only at the federal level. Medical tax is 1.45%. And that's what individuals pay. The employer will pay 1.45%. The Medicare tax will pay for your Medicare health insurance when you turn 65. We'll talk about that when we cover health insurance in a later module. The third type of tax are Social Security taxes. Again, these are federal tax, and individual pays 6.2%, and the employer pay another 6.2%. For Social Security, there is a maximum income. So every year up to X dollar is subject to Social Security tax. Anything above that, you will not pay Social Security tax on. Of course, Social Security tax help fund the Social Security system. So once you turn 67 and a half, you'll be able to receive Social Security benefits. When we talk about retirement, we'll go over those benefits in details. If you are a self-employed entrepreneur, you need to pay some special attention. If you want to be able to qualify for Medicare benefits, you have to pay the entire 2.9% Medicare tax because you are your own employer. So you'll pay the 1.45% and you have to pay the 1.45% that an employer typically pay. So together, 1.45 plus 1.45 will give you 2.9%. The same is true for Social Security. If you are self-employed and you want to qualify for Social Security benefit, you have to pay the Social Security tax. And because you're also your own employer, you have to pay the entire 12.4%. In addition to taxes that are related to your income, a lot of states will also have tax on your property. Federal, there's no federal tax on property. So property tax vary by states. Some have property tax on houses, automobiles. Some even have taxes on personal properties. And then in addition to that, some of us will have to pay sales tax. A lot of states have sales tax. Some can be as high as 5%, 6%. And some states don't have sales tax. Something that's different from sales tax are excise tax. Excise tax are on specific goods. The most common ones are alcohol and gasoline. Again, these are state specific. Estate tax, sometimes they're called inheritance tax. This is tax on when there is inheritance that are passed from one generation to the next. The federal estate tax, this is the tax that is at the federal level. And here's another truth or myth question. Do death taxes bankrupt families? Well, to answer that question, you may want to do some research yourself. Go ahead and do a internet search and find out what the current lifetime limit is on federal estate tax. So the exemption amount means that anything below this amount, you do not have to pay inheritance tax on. In 2024, the federal tax exemption is actually $13.6 million. So in other words, if your inheritance is less than $13.6 million, you will not pay any tax at all. It's only when your inheritance is more than $13.6 million, then you have to pay tax on the amount above $13.6 million. So the first $13.6 million is not taxed at all. So the truth is that most people do not pay inheritance tax. And of course, if you look hard enough, you'll find one or two special cases where inheritance tax could create a hardship. An example would be if you inherit a business that is worth more than $13.6 million, a lot more, because remember, the first $13.6 million is not subject to tax. And you don't have any money to pay the amount that is subject to tax. Again, that is a very extreme case, very highly unlikely. Could that happen? Of course. Is it common? Extremely, extremely uncommon. In addition to federal estate tax, some states also have inheritance tax. So again, we have 50 states in the United States. Your state is unique. So go ahead and do some research on whether or not your own state have an inheritance tax. And also, remember, there's an exemption amount, which means that you only have to worry about inheritance taxes if your expected inheritance is over the exemption amount. The last type of tax are gift tax, and the gift tax is usually paid by the donor. That means it's the person giving the gift. So you, as the person receiving the gift, you do not have to worry about paying tax. Also, each gift that you receive that is below the annual exclusion amount is not subject to tax. So similar to the inheritance tax, there is an exclusion amount. How much is that? For federal in, again, 2024, the exclusion amount is $18,000. So unless you are gifting someone more than $18,000, you do not have to pay tax. So up to $18,000, you can gift to anyone. So again, is individual. So and that is not subject to tax. And even if you are a couple married jointly, that is on an individual basis. So for example, if you have grandparents who want to give you money, each of your grandparents can give you $18,000 per grandparent. So again, it can happen, but it's not very common. So why do we pay taxes? The number one reason for tax is to pay for public goods and services. And the term public goods has a very special meaning in economics. Public good here means that these are things that benefits everyone, and they cannot be individualized. A good example are roads. So you cannot limit one person to use the road, and you can build a road and then nobody else can use it. Another one is a judicial system. So you cannot really say the law applies to one person but not another person. Same is for defense. So those are very commonly taxes that are supported by income tax. Similarly, within a local area, so such as a town, property tax oftentimes are used to fund schools and local police, firefighter, and so forth. So you don't want to get in situation, for example, firefighting, that you have to pay a firefighter before they will come and put out the fire in your home. So again, those things don't make sense. Let's take a minute. Think about what other examples can you come up with for public goods and services. Another very important question that relates to tax is fairness. Because this public goods and services benefit everyone, so who should pay for them? So how would you define a fair share of tax? Should the people who have more means, meaning more income or more wealth, pay more? Or should it be equal? Everybody pay the same amount? Or should it be based on who is going to use the services more? So all those are different ways to determine what makes a tax system fair. And there's no easy answer to that. However, it is important question to ask and important questions to consider. Next, let's take a look at the more practical aspect of tax. In the United States, federal income tax deadline is April 15, and almost all the states follow the same. So when you have to file your federal tax, typically you also have to file your state tax. The form for individuals at the federal level is number 1040. So some of you may have already filed taxes before, and that is you have to complete 1040. If you don't know how to complete the tax form, there are lots of resources available to help you. Some of them are free. The most popular program is VITA, which stands for Volunteer Income Tax Assistant Program. And if you're a college student, oftentimes your campus have a VITA program. In addition to using the service, you can also become a volunteer. You do not need to know how to do taxes before you volunteer. The IRS and the school who's providing the VITA service will actually train all the students. It's a great experience if your school offers it. Another place to get help is actually through the government. The IRS website actually have a lot of useful information. So instead of just relying on Google search, I really encourage everyone to go directly to the government website. In addition to free help, you can also pay for services. You can pay for in-person tax preparation services, or you can purchase a tax software, which basically did all the calculation for you and walk you through step by step. You don't have to do anything except answering the relevant questions. We will pause the video here. And in the next video, we're going to continue with going through a detailed step-by-step how to compute your tax using Form 1040 and also go through an actual numerical example. See you soon.